How did you end up homeless?
Well, that's a long story.
I lost my job, and the person I was staying with, I couldn't pay my rent.
I came out as transgender my senior year in college, and I lost all of my family support.
Well, I've always had that desire to get off the streets. It's just been hard.
It's a hard look at something many of us see every day from the perspective of those experiencing it. We're talking about homelessness. And the problem is getting worse. Between 2014 and 2020, California's homeless population grew by more than 40%, ballooning to more than 161,000 people. And with shelters at their limits, more and more of those people are living on the street. Who are they? Who are the human beings behind the statistics? Their lives and their struggle to escape their desperate circumstances are the subject of the Netflix documentary, Lead Me Home. It has been nominated for an Academy Award in the Best Documentary Short category. I'd like to welcome the directors of Lead Me Home, Pedro Koss and John Shenk, to Frank Buckley Interviews. Gentlemen, welcome and congratulations on the Oscar nomination.
Thank you so much, Frank. It's a pleasure to be here.
I'd also like to welcome Nathan Sheets, who you saw there. He's the executive director of the Center in Hollywood. That's a local homeless outreach provider. Nathan, welcome to you as well.
Thank you, Frank.
So Pedro and John, homelessness is such a complex issue. So many parts to it. Why did you decide to take this on?
Well, you know, as you see in the film, at the end of the day, the people that we included in the film are people. They're our neighbors. They're human beings. And Pedro lives in Los Angeles. I live in the San Francisco Bay Area. We both see this with our own eyes day to day. And we just realized that there was a crisis of humanity happening right outside our front door. And we felt like there was a need to humanize the situation that so often gets dehumanized in the media.
And Pedro, I would say that, you know, if you live here in LA, I'm coming to you right now from our studio, which is at Sunset and Van Ness. And for a time, there was a group of people who were living right there at the off-ramp. They have since been asked to move, but there's still an RV there, things piled up there. We do see it here in Hollywood every day. I see it. I live in the Valley. Part of the film takes us to the Sepulveda Basin, a place where I cycle frequently, and I cycle by these people. And I always wonder, how did they get to this place? And what did you find to that question?
Well, thank you, Frank. And first of all, I'm actually not too far away from you right now. I live in Hollywood as well, and not too just walking distance to the center. The process of making this film was an extraordinary education because the stories are as varied as the stars in the sky, really. I mean, people from every walks of life and every background. And it was truly heartbreaking. It was more of a portrait of ourselves and a system that is really not working. We became friends. We became close with the people that you meet in the film. And I think one of the extraordinary things is that they, resilient, and, you know, it was important for us to break down the walls and the barriers that, you know, that we've built as a society and connect it on a really basic human level. And that was really sort of our plan as we proceeded along in the making of the film.
And Nathan, I alluded to this earlier, but it is such a complex issue. I did a documentary, as I told all of you earlier, when I was a college student about the homeless issue. And at the time, I remember talking to Mitch Snyder in Washington, D.C. about the issue of should people be staying in a big warehouse setting, or what are the different ways that we can get services to people who need them? You deal with this every day. And I just wonder, have things improved since I worked on a documentary in the 80s? Or have things gotten worse?
Well, again, thanks for having me. Things have definitely gotten worse in many ways. And the one thing that I think is often overlooked is the reality of the economic implications that drive people into homelessness. I think a lot of times we misdirect our focus on substance use and mental illness when those are really more results of the traumas of living on the street rather than the causes for homelessness. So, I mean, what we've seen is there's been critical investment in the issue, and yet the issue just continues to grow. And so organizations like ours and our partners are pivoting quickly. I mean, we've housed thousands and thousands of people, but the inflow just keeps happening. And the numbers keep growing because, I mean, largely we just don't have enough housing for people, and we don't have the interventions to scale to meet the need as it exists now and even as it's growing.
Well, that's something I've just learned, because that is surprising to hear what you said about the fact that the drug addiction and the mental health issues are not necessarily the causes. And I just wonder, to the filmmakers, I'd ask, what were some of the things that were preconceptions that you might have had about the homelessness issue that might have changed as a result of your 3-year-long effort to understand it?
What you see in the film is people going about their daily lives. You know, you see a guy like Lewis who wakes up in his bedroom, which happens to be a tent under an overpass, gets up, brushes his teeth, goes to have breakfast, needs to do his laundry. Eventually you see him fall in love. I think what broke down our preconceived notions is that these people who are experiencing homelessness at the end of the day are people that we have much more in common with than we do that separates us. And we realize that human beings by nature, look for places to nest, find safety, find comfort, find food and clothing, those kinds of things. We all have that in common. It's just that these humans who, like Nathan was saying, have fallen out of our economic system due to pressures that really, in many ways, have nothing to do with them as individuals, need to figure out a way to do that on the streets without a whole lot of resource. And so that really kind of changed our whole thinking about how to tell the story.
Pedro, what about you?
Exactly the same. I think there's more that unites us than separates us, and so much more. And, you know, we've, it's a lot. If I was pushed out into the streets, I would be experiencing the same issues that we see. And I think a lot of the times it is the lack of support on so many levels that I think was really surprising and shattered every single preconceived notion. I mean, we met families that, because of medical emergencies, were forced to live out in the streets. I mean, that is one of many very common stories that we started here. You know, as you see in the film, you know, issues like domestic violence, unemployment. I mean, as I said earlier, it's, you know, as varied as the stars in the sky. And I think what we begin to see as the causes are actually the symptoms of being forced out.
You talked about the case of the woman who suffered through that domestic violence, and it is one of the most heartbreaking parts of the film. She's trying to maintain a dignity with her children to make sure that they're clothed and fed and protected. How is it that a woman like that ends up in that place? Why couldn't she get help immediately? Isn't there some sort of a safety net or an infrastructure in place where she can go and say, I'm in crisis, help me?
You know, I don't know where to begin. Yeah, of course, that was one of the things that I think a lot of people who haven't been in this situation don't quite get. I think, you know, one thing we sort of figured out is if you can imagine your life, if you take away family support, take away a lot of the education opportunities you had, take away your health insurance, take away your, you know, relatively well-paying job for a minimum wage job, and suddenly the safety net you know, that holds your life together just sort of dissolves. And, you know, when something terrible happens, like you lost insurance or you've been the victim of violence or trauma, where do you turn? And we've just found that over and over again with people that this kind of straw that broke the camel's back, you know, they lost their apartment, they lived in their car, the car broke down, they couldn't afford to fix it. Now, where do they go? And it's sort of this sort of stair-stepping down kind of moment that happens in their life where the system doesn't work for them anymore. And, you know, we as human beings came to believe that there's got to be a way to help the 600,000 Americans who are falling out of the system that seems in many ways sort of rigged against them.
Nathan, exactly. is there's this feeling that I feel that I think some people have, which is, look, if you want to be off the street, you can be off the street. There are services, organizations like yours, churches, shelters, where you can be off the street if you choose to be. Is that correct or not?
It's not necessarily correct. I mean, it definitely is a lot more challenging. And I mean, for a lot of the reasons that Pedro and that John are talking about, each situation is so different. The interventions have to be tailored to meet the person, to be more human-centered. And unfortunately, the resources we have are constrained to categorize people and to put them into boxes. And it just simply doesn't work sustainably half the time. Our approaches just aren't human-centered enough to meet the person where they are, to be truly low barrier. So making services accessible to people. And then, you know, for people who've been on the streets for a really long time, there's a long period of time that has to go into building trust again, because even the traumas that they've experienced have come from getting into housing and even falling out by trust being broken, even with case managers or people who've been sort of indebted to help them. So it's possible people can get through it, but it comes back again to the capacity issue. We don't have enough resources, especially for those who've been on the streets a long time, for every person to just simply be able to get off the streets immediately.
All right, we're going to take a short break at that moment. And when we come back, I would like to go deeper into the homelessness issue and what we can do about it.
Guys, get your stuff. They're coming down here.
This 200-bed navigation center will import a massive homeless population and will harm the surrounding neighborhood.
Where do you want them to go? There's nowhere for anyone to go.
It's another clip from the documentary, Oscar-nominated documentary short, Lead Me Home. We're back with the directors of the film, Pedro Koss and John Shenk, and with Nathan Sheets, the executive director of the center in Hollywood. Gentlemen, we wanted to share that particular clip because it touches on something that comes up in the film, which is the idea that solving homelessness isn't just about the homeless. Obviously, it's about all of us, and that makes projects that could help to get people off the street more difficult to accomplish. And my question to you is are people who've worked very hard to buy their homes, who've seen people attacked by people who live on the streets, who've seen the addiction and the mental illness, are they justified in saying, not in my neighborhood? I'll ask the filmmakers first, and then Nathan, I want you to answer that as well.
You know, that is a great question, Frank. And one of the things that I think we've seen in sort of the debate and the dialogue around homelessness around the country is a lot of it is coming from fear. You know, I think a lot of the media narratives have really perpetuated an us versus them, an otherizing. And I think one of the things that we have to understand is that it's our neighbors, our brothers and sisters, could be any one of us. There's shortly after the clip that you just said, we just saw, there is that same outreach worker says to the young woman who is he's taking to the shelter, says, I am one paycheck away from being in the tent right next to you. And that gets to the heart of like the vulnerability. And I think it's one of the things that we have to see is that we are, this is a film about us. This is not a film about homelessness. It's a film about all of us in our society and how our system that we have is currently not working. And so when you get to sort of the, like are they, you know, get them, you know, not about, but this is all of our backyards. And this is something that's universal. And I think, you know, hopefully we can have a little bit more compassion and have systems and the services that can really accommodate the demand, because there is a lot of demand and there's a humanitarian crisis out on ours, you know, in our cities. And I think we need to acknowledge that and treat it as a humanitarian crisis first.
John, do you have a thought?
Yeah, you know, in many ways, us people who have the privilege of living in a home that, like you said, many of us have worked hard for, are also the victims of a greater systemic problem. You know, Pedro and I, when we went into this project, spent months researching and talking to people who know much more about this than we do. And we learned that, you know, there's historical forces at work here that go back to the 1980s when we changed our tax policy and we changed our healthcare policies and we started to dismantle some of the safety net programs that we had earlier in our history. And we also, I think there's been talking points from, you know, politicians that have tended to blame the victims here, which are not just the people who experience homelessness, but they're the cities who are kind of left holding the bag when it comes to, you know, the vast populations of homeless people out on the streets.
Yeah.
And so I would encourage people to who do live in neighborhoods where there is a quote unquote homeless problem to maybe just at times step back and think about the larger role forces that led these people here. And rather than blame the people who were, you know, on the streets looking for help, think about what they could do as citizens of their cities and of this country to try to slowly change the policy so that we don't have this problem with our system.
Nathan, I consider myself to be a compassionate human being. I want to do something to help in this issue, but I also do want our sidewalks clear of people. I don't think it's humane to let people live on the sidewalk. And so convince me, tell me what I can do and to be this compassionate person that I know that I am, but also have an ordered society.
I mean, I think it goes back a little bit to just thinking about the effort of the documentary itself to humanize the crisis. I believe that when I've seen the biggest transformation from people in the neighborhood or just simply frustrated and want to walk in their neighborhood on clean sidewalks, has been when there's been an opportunity from providers or by our elected officials to humanize the crisis, to put people in the same rooms at times or even in safe spaces that are controlled so that we start to understand and have compassion from that level. And from that level, then I think advocacy can happen to where, you know, we, with an educated perspective, with having access to seeing the faces or getting to know the people and their circumstances, it makes a much more cogent argument. And also just in terms of thinking about the crisis, gives us an idea to advocate to see these, to address these system issues that we're facing. And I think the reality is we also just need to find a way for more people in a large swath of the city like Los Angeles to say yes, that building housing actually is, it will benefit them in turn, and it's not going to turn a neighborhood into a bad place to live just because there are people who are formerly homeless living in the neighborhood. It'll actually make the neighborhood better and safer. So it's an uphill climb that I feel like a lot of us are fighting to advocate for these things, but I think it does start with being able to do more of what the documentary endeavors to do, to open up spaces like we do here at the center in controlled environments where people from the neighborhood, from the charter school across the street can come over and interact and then put a real human face in an interaction. And I think that goes a long way.
I only have a minute here, but is the system broken in terms of the policy side? There are people like you who are doing the good work on the ground, but we have the money in our government coffers. Is it going to the right places? Are we focusing on the right things? Nathan?
I mean, I'll go back again to the system. I would I I feel a little bit silly saying that the system is broken when a lot of times the system is doing exactly what it was designed to do. And the reality is, yes, there are resources, but going back to my initial comment, a lot of the resources just simply aren't accessible for the people who they were designed for. And I think about that when it relates to our healthcare system or our mental health system, which does affect a lot of the folks who perpetually end up on the streets because of, for instance, like medical bills. We need more accessible systems and they need to be more human-centered. And I think the reality is, yes, there are resources, but they have to be targeted specifically at meeting people where they are instead of trying to fit them into boxes.
All right. One final break here, and we're going to come back in just a moment with Pedro Koss and John Shenk, Mr. Sheets, directors of the Oscar-nominated documentary short, Lead Me Home. Nathan is the director of the Center in Hollywood. Well, we are out of time, but I want to thank Pedro Koss, John Shenk, and Nathan Sheets. Pedro's and John's movie is Lead Me Home. It's been nominated for an Oscar in the Best Documentary Short category. You can see it right now streaming on Netflix. It's 40 minutes that is well worth your time. And you can learn more about Nathan's work at the Center in Hollywood by going to their website. That's thecenterinhollywood.org. At that website, you'll also see that there's someone there named Frank Buckley, and it's not me. but Nathan can explain that to you when you call them and do your best to pitch in yourself. Thanks to all of you for joining us, and thank you for watching. I hope you'll join us on the audio podcast later this week, where we will continue the conversation.